Welcome, my name is Lenny Mathis. I'm a senior associate group ED for external operations, and I welcome you today to our USC Upstate Athletics Hall of Fame banquet and induction ceremony for our three honorees today, which are Brittany Starling, Anna Milan-Nickel, and Ramiro Blanco, who is living in Argentina, is unable to join us today, but will join us virtually here in a few minutes via tape. Please feel free to eat during the proceedings. If you need to get something to drink or whatnot, the food will be available throughout today's ceremony. This is an exciting day for those of you and their family members going into the Hall of Fame. It's literally once-in-a-lifetime opportunity, and it's been great to see how many people have shared this on social media and how many people are celebrating either here today or have been celebrating since we announced this a few weeks ago. Today's ceremony will also show up on YouTube later on. We will be putting this in the post-production later, and we will show this later this week. We'll be able to share this out with everybody who was unable to attend in person. We'll be able to do that online. Today's a busy day. It is homecoming 2022 here at USC Upstate. Today's a busy day. This kicks off things. We've got an alumni awards event across campus. It starts at 11. We've got a men's soccer exhibition with North Greenville at County University Soccer Stadium at noon. In the midst of that, there's a huge tailgate that'll be happening right outside of the soccer baseball complex near the HEC. That's got about 800 people, 1,000 people planning to come to that. The softball team, Coach Chris Hawkins, the head coach of our softball program, is here. They're having a decent year. They're 33-3. They will host Winthrop at 1 o'clock today over Cyril Stadium, and our honorees here will be part of the ceremony on the first pitches of that. We invite you to join us over there at 1 o'clock for that, and hopefully Coach will not leave Anna in the circle to start the game. And then the baseball team wraps up today's events. They start at 4 against High Point. They're also having a really good year. They're 17-9, 6-1 in the Big South. And they will take on High Point again at 4. So with that, just want to kind of give you the lay of the land of today. And we'll start today off by welcoming our Vice Chancellor and Director of Athletics, Daniel Fine.
Excited to be here. This is always such a great and celebratory day to celebrate our new incoming inductees of the Hall of Fame. Anna, Brittany, and Ramiro, we couldn't be more proud of you and more excited to have you here. And so congratulations and welcome. Before we get started today, I do want to thank a few folks as I look around the room. I know, as Lenny mentioned, a lot of folks celebrating online have been calling and texting and emailing. In addition, we have some staff and faculty here today that I'd love to thank. Keith Hansen as a supporter of our student athletes is here. Thank you, Keith. Stacy Mills, working student affairs with our students here. Thank you so much for coming. And last but not least, our new chancellor, Dr. Benny Harris. And so if you haven't met Dr. Harris, our new students, I want you to say hello to Dr. Harris. I want to say a few things here about Dr. Harris and about our university for a minute, especially for our alumni, because the university is evolving and changing. We're so excited to have Dr. Harris and his leadership here. He's been here for about 9 months, and if you live in the Upstate, you already know Dr. Harris because he's everywhere all the time. Every you see it online, he is out and about pushing the message of how great this university is and how great we're going to continue to be and evolve and grow. We're so excited for his leadership and his bold vision. He's also a big supporter of athletics, had a son that was a collegiate athlete, and that's so important to our athletic department as we move forward to have that same vision. I know he sees us as a pathway to our community and a way to invite folks to campus and grow our university enrollment and grow our presence in the community and in the region. So if you don't mind, please give Dr. Harris and our staff a round of applause. I also want to thank our Hall of Fame selection committee that's chaired by Chris Hawkins. It's all Hall of Famers, everyone on this committee. And so Chris is actually in the Hall of Fame, for those of you that didn't know, as a baseball player here at USC Upstate. The other members of our committee are Beth Baer, Dr. Joe Bowman, Skip Fry, Carla Gambrell, Wendell Gibson, Josh Gallman, and Scott Hawkett. And they came together and looked through a large number of nominees. We're so excited to have kind of revamped that process the last few years and tightened it up and have a real deep selection criteria. And so that's a hard job to have a bunch of Hall of Famers looking through there. And so you all should be so excited and even that much more, you're that much more worthy because you're up against so many great nominees and you accomplished so much. So thank you so much to our committee for all your hard work. You know, that process has changed and our university is changing. I want to mention a few things to our alumni here. You know, pre-pandemic, our university was up to 6,300 students, our largest enrollment ever. And, you know, our plan with Dr. Harris's vision is to get to 10 or 12,000 in the next 5 to 10 years. We want to keep growing. We're adding programs all the time to address issues and workforce needs in our community. The university is evolving and changing, adding master's programs, exercise science this fall to help out. We'll have some athletics and GAs in that program. So we're excited as the university moves forward. I would encourage you to take a tour of campus today. You're drinking Starbucks today. When you were here, there wasn't a Starbucks on campus. There is now. And so, you know, we were updating some buildings. The library had a multi-million-dollar renovation. Smith Science just had one. We're adding some new facilities over the next few years. And so the university is really moving forward. In like manner, the athletic department is moving forward. One big change since all you all were here is that we're now in a different conference. You were in a great conference with the Atlantic Sun, but you know you missed a few classes when you were in that conference. You traveled from New Jersey to South Florida, over to Nashville, and everywhere in between. And now we're in a conference that we really, I think this aligns perfectly with who we are. We're playing schools only in North and South Carolina and Virginia, and it's just great for our student athletes to miss so many less classes, but to also play against schools that our student body recognizes and that we know we have rivalries with. Just like today, our softball team is playing Winthrop. All of our students know who Winthrop is, and they're excited to beat them. So I hope you all will be out there and cheer loudly. At the last few years, as an athletic department, you know, we've really tried to address some needs and really trying to push forward and be as competitive as we can. We started our first ever strategic plan, so we have a plan as to where to go. And part of that mission of our plan, we came up with a mission statement, and it is to develop champions on the field, to build scholars in the classroom, and to prepare leaders for life. And I want to talk a minute about that and about how you all embody that. Our department is looking at those three pillars of what we're trying to do. And so on the field, I will share with you that in our commissioner's cup, which measures our success across the entire department, we want to be excellent in all sports, that we've gotten up to fourth, which we've never been that high before. We averaged eighth, and we're now fourth. That's great. It's no one's goal to be fourth. Our goal is to be first, and we're well on our way. But last year we were fourth. This year we're on pace to be that well or higher. And we're so excited to have that growth and that excellence across all sports. We're taking steps forward. Our student athletes had a 3.2 GPA last year, over two-thirds of them, with over a 3.0. So they're getting it done in the classroom. And we're preparing them for life through a robust life skills program and a number of programs that help them address needs and help them prepare so they can be successful after school when they graduate. So our department is flourishing, and here we are with three of you, and I want to talk about how all three of you briefly met with our goals, right? Our three pillars of our program. Number one, you all graduated, so I'm so excited. That's the number one goal when you come here as a student athlete. You're here today because you embody athletic excellence. Right, and we're going to talk about that in a few minutes, about all your wonderful accomplishments on the field or on the court. And what I'm really excited about is, and I know we'll get into this, about what you're doing now, but you are leaders in life now, and you're preparing young people for leaders in life. You all will get to hear a little bit today that all three of our inductees are working professionally to help young people, help mold them into leaders for tomorrow. Anna is a college softball coach, which is fantastic, having an opportunity to lead students into becoming young women through the sport of softball. Brittany is an athletic director at the YMCA and helping lead hundreds and hundreds of young children through leadership, through athletics, to prepare them for life. And Ramiro owns his own company in Argentina, where with another gentleman, he is recruiting students to American universities to live out their dreams in athletics and change the trajectory of their lives. So they're all three impacting athletics and young people and leading them to be better and stronger and preparing them to be leaders in life. So I couldn't be more proud of you all. I'm so excited to welcome you today into our Hall of Fame. So congratulations and welcome.
let's get this party started, as they say. Our first inductee who will join us on the stage right now is Anna Miller Nickel. To not put an entire speech on our Hall of Famers. We are doing it in interview form. So
appreciate it.
Yes, well, and I didn't even surprise our honorees with, they actually know exactly what I'm about to ask them, which makes it even better. So, Anna, what does it mean for you to be a USC Upstate Athletic Hall of Famer?
It is an incredible honor. I mean, the time I spent here was so special. The community, the coaches, the staff, the teammates I got to play with, all incredible people, all very deserving, all very hardworking. And to be a part of the class of people being brought into this very exclusive group is a huge honor. It's pretty unbelievable, actually. I was only here for 2 years. I transferred from a junior college. And so to be included in that as someone who it was really part of the team and community, it means a lot to me.
Well, speaking of your journey here to USC Upstate, let's go through that. You're not from around here, as they say. You're from the West Coast, but then going to your junior college experience and how you came to USC Upstate.
Yeah, so I was incredibly fortunate to land at the junior college I did. The head coach there, Doug Eastman, who's now at Yavapai, he aggressively recruited me and was like, I'm going to help take you to the next level. And I was like, okay. But he truly believed in me, supported me, pushed me farther, and when I got to the end of my freshman year, my sophomore, he's like, you know this program called USC Upstate, and I've sent some girls there before, and I think you'd be a good fit there. And so he got me in touch with Coach Hopkins and Coach Pack and Coach Polly, and I came on my visit. And I'd been on a visit a couple days before that, came here, absolutely fell in love with not only the coaching staff, but the campus and the people here. I knew as soon as I sat down and talked with Coach Polly, I was like, I'm done, I'm sold, this is where I'm coming. And to feel that way, I had never felt that, like, just called to be here. So I knew it was the right fit, and Coach Hopkins is someone who just, you know, tells it like it is, and he said, you know, I think you can make a big impact here, and I mean, look at him, he was right.
And we're going to get to Coach Hawkins in just a second. I realize I've just gone off script. At least let's learn more about Anna Miller.
A native of Portland, Oregon, Anna Miller Nickel competed on the softball team from 2013 to 2014. During her time as a Spartan, Nickel played an essential role in the circle for Upstate, and her efforts at Upstate led her to be the second player ever drafted into the National Pro Fast Pitch League. In her 2 seasons at Upstate, Nickel recorded 193 and two-thirds innings pitched and 290 strikeouts, and she also had a 23-6 career record, including 16 career complete games, 11 shutouts, while also tying the school record for career no-hitters with 6. Her senior season brought Nickel massive success as she stacked several accolades, just one of which was being the only player in school history to have ever pitched a perfect game in an NCAA regional. She was named the 2014 A-Sun Pitcher of the Year and the 2014 A-Sun Scholar Athlete of the Year, while garnering first-team A-Sun and all-academic team recognitions. She was also named a 2014 Capital One First-Team Academic All-American and a 2014 NFCA Second-Team All-Region Selection and a 2014 A-Sun NCAA Woman of the Year candidate. During her first year as a Spartan, she would contribute in Upstate's A-Sun Tournament Championship, and she would throw that perfect game in 5 innings against Jacksonville State in the NCAA Regional. At the time, it was just the second perfect game in program history and the first at the Division I level. Please welcome Anna Miller Nickel.
I love how we went on script. We're like, oh, yeah.
And I'm the one that wrote the script. Let's have a chance to talk with your head coach, Chris Hawkins, here. Anna just shared her story with how she became a Spartan. You are a Hall of Famer, as Daniel mentioned before. Let's talk about your perspective of Anna and bringing her here to Upstate.
You know, we had an opportunity to get her. Doug Eastman is a very good coach and said, hey, this kid is raw, but it's going to be real, real good. So we gave her opportunity to come here. Rick Pauley, which was here at the time, ended up being the assistant pitching coach at Georgia that left and went there. But he made her into exactly what our program's about. If you wonder about Upstate, we usually get, if you call it, maybe a three-star athlete, and we turn them into fives. Well, she turned into about an eight. So we're going to all these SEC schools, and we're just beating them, and they're all like, who's this pitcher? Where's this pitcher from? Well, she's throwing 68, 69 miles an hour. Now she's got a changeup. She's 5'10". But one of the biggest things that she actually taught me is she's like the most positive person in the world. And as a head coach, you have a tendency to be negative a whole lot. But she's really changed my life as much as you know, she's helped us as well. So she is an awesome kid, a perfect person. She always has a smile on her face. So if you ever got down, you just stared at Anna. She always had to smile. It made you feel a little bit better. But, you know, I could almost take a nap when she pitched. If I got one run, I was usually good. So it was very fortunate for us to have her. If she throws out the first pitch today, I'm sure that you're probably going to throw it hard. So we'll have some people there to hopefully catch it. But if you saw in the film, I mean, we're playing 15 Power 5 schools. We're beating most all of them. And we're doing it here at USC Upstate. And that's kind of what we want to do here at school with all of our sports, is to play on that national level. And getting players like Anna Miller enabled us to do that and enabled us to do it very well. So I think she's a phenomenal kid. She babysitted my kids when they were little. There's a lot I owe her, way more than she owes me.
And as I see it, she is good for about 23 of your now 1,015 career wins. So
I wish she'd been here 4 years.
Yeah, no, but a lot more than that. Anna, can you share one of your favorite moments or a game experience? Obviously, you threw a perfect game on a regional, but some of your favorite moments from here as a Spartan.
I mean, there's a ton of them, so I'll try to narrow them down. It has to be winning the conference tournament at Lipscomb in Nashville. And I think one of the clips is from me like, yeah! Like, I was so elated. I mean, when you go into these games, it was a great conference. You were playing tough games all the time. And during that game, I mean, we had diving catches. We had hard hit balls. Like, we were truly like, it was like a dance, right? Where everything is moving in perfect choreography and things just happen when they need to happen and the right things are being done and you're getting lucky, you know, I'll take every ounce of luck you can get in a game, something falling in your favor. But it's just, I can think back to all the great defensive plays because I can only do so much, right? I'm throwing a ball and then believing that everyone else behind me has my back, and to work together and truly feel like everyone behind you has your back and you have theirs, like, you can really be yourself and you can really push yourself to the next level because you can trust everyone behind you and you know that they're making decisions for the team and for the betterment of each other. And that's one of my, by far, my favorite memories. And honestly, the perfect game, when you throw a perfect game, you don't want to think about throwing a perfect game. You're like, I don't know, it's just, I'm just pitching. Like, you want to stay focused because as soon as you start thinking, you're thinking ahead, right? You're thinking about the end, you're thinking about the result. And I know the fastest way to not get the result you want is to try to force a result. Like, working hard, staying consistent, doing what your coach should do. Those are the kind of things that lead to a perfect game. It's not, I'm going to go throw a perfect game today. Like, if you had said, I'm going to go throw a perfect game, I probably would have given up six runs that day. But going in and saying, I'm going to stay focused and keep my head down and look at that as one pitch at a time, one inning at a time, and not looking ahead is really what makes the difference. And in the perfect game, the very first ball that was hit to Maddie at shortstop, and she makes an incredible diving play, lays out, grabs it, and that could have been the end of that, then the very first hit of the game. So I just think back to the importance of the people around you, and they're the things that make the thing special. It's not the thing itself, it's the people around you and the incredible athleticism and just the show of themselves that really makes it special.
And I'm going to go slightly off script with this next one, but it has to do with your no-hitters and your perfect game. So most of us in the room may not have a chance to sit in the dugout and be on a bench or whatnot, but does anybody talk to you when you're in the middle of look around and you go, no. Does anybody talk to you? You just kind of, like you said, you try to keep it very even, but does everybody else just kind of ignore you?
Yeah, it's kind of a jinx if you say, well, yeah, you're throwing a no-hitter, you're throwing a game. It's like, boom, someone gets a hit.
I probably should talk to you, though.
Oh, I'm, and Polly, I mean, they know, they're charting. They're like, yeah, no one's been on base today. That's interesting. So it's that. I mean, and I gave up more walks than I would have liked to. And so usually there was a walk or two in there because I was aggressive. I wanted to go for the strikeout. And so I walk more people than ideally want to. But, you know, when those games all come together really nicely, get great outcomes. And again, the defense, like, I cannot stress enough how incredible our defense was. Like, Kendall at third base, I mean, if there was a ball to be fielded, she had it. Dana at second, Shannon at first, like, if there was a ball hitting the infield, they were out. We had the best defense, I think, in the nation, actually, my junior year. Not a joke. So incredible. And that has nothing to do with me. That has everything to do with the coaching staff developing and the athletes themselves. Like, our defense worked harder than anyone I've ever met in my entire life. It doesn't matter what level you're at. Like, they went to work, got the job done. I cannot give them enough kudos, because literally they are the reason I have the success I have, because without them, I am nothing. Like, it takes a full team to be successful.
And that defense is a hallmark of Coach Hawkins' his teams here over the years, certainly. Point out some of the influential people in your career here at the USC Upstate. You've gone through some of the story of getting here, but some of the others have really made a big impact on you.
I mean, we've got to start with Coach Hawkins. I mean, the program he developed, obviously he's the man. And honestly, getting to babysit his kids and hang out with their family really made me feel like I belonged here, made me feel like it was part of that family atmosphere, which is hard. I mean, coming from Oregon, you know pretty much no one. And so being here and, you know, babysitting the kids, which seems kind of like a silly thing, but having that time with them and the boys and just, like, getting to, and he was not relaxed at the field, but at home, super relaxed. So you also get to know him as a person versus just as a coach. So, I mean, Coach Hawkins, Coach Pack, I mean, Coach Pack was, like, such a good recruiter. Just like, hey, you really need to check out this program. You need to see what we got going on. Just very enthusiastic and passionate. And then Rick Polly, who by, like, he was like my pitching dad. Like, my actual dad is here, and my dad couldn't catch me. He was like, no, I'm like, pass. I like my shins in my face. But Coach Polly was like kind of like my pitching dad, where he was like, not only helped me develop as a pitcher physically, but mentally. He believed in me so deeply. There was a time, I want to say, halfway through my junior year, where we decided to change my motion to the motion everyone sees on the film, from this, like, big, sweepy motion, and I trusted him enough not only to change it, but then he was patient enough with me to push me along to say, no, we need to stay the path, And for someone to believe in you that deeply, that's hard, because when I was not doing well for a little bit there, I had some rough games, and he's just like, nope, keep doing it, keep working with me. He never gave up on me. So incredibly important. I mean, and not to mention all the great teachers, Keith Hansen, Jeff Smith, Brian Smith from the Georgia Business School, like Hannah Turpak. I just had so many great people who not only impacted my life on the field, but then also off the field. And Brian Seville, who ran our marketing department at that time, like, I got to intern in the office. Oh my gosh, Bill. Bill was our SID, and he wrote up all the really nice things about me. Like, it takes everyone. I think that, yes, I may be getting recognized, but it's everyone else who supports you and puts you up for things and takes care of you. I always can't emphasize how important the people around you are, and no matter where you go in life.
How has this experience here at USC Upstate prepared you for your role now? You're a collegiate pitching coach. You are now in the role that Coach Pauly was in when you were here in Pacific Lutheran. Talk about your experience here and how it's prepared you for the next generation.
I never realized how patient he was for me. Like, I knew, but now I really know. The patience to meet an athlete where they're at and pull them forward, not where you think they should be or who you want them to be, but truly meet an athlete where they're at and then walk them forward. And truly, he made me feel like there was nothing stupid I could ask. There were, like, I could just be like, I don't understand, and he would take the time to explain and, like, pull me along. Even when I was like, oh, I don't know what we're doing, I'm frustrated, he took the time to pull me along. And the patience and ability to see, not only see where I could go, but help me get there, walk me there. I really bring that into the practice at Pacific Lutheran, and really helping girls see, like, hey, I know you're here, but we're gonna get you here, and we're gonna walk you there step by step. It's a lot of learning, a lot of patience, a lot of pushing yourself. At the end of the day, I have to push myself, and they have to push themselves. And I mean, you are at the mercy of your own will to push yourself along, but my goal is to really help them see, like, hey, it's worth pushing yourself along. It's worth putting that extra rep in, that extra day in, that extra thing that's going to help you get to the next level, because it does take extra. If you just put in the minimum, you won't get anything out of it. Like, you need to push yourself. You think you're at a 10? Well, we think you can get to a 15. So I got to push you along and tell you that we see more in there. So my time here was incredibly impactful in that. And then in the classroom, I mean, I took a very heavy class load because, again, transferring in, you lose some classes, so I took a really heavy class load, and just that class load and school, and softball, and, you know, also trying to be a regular social human, it was hard. And so that rigor and that focus it took to achieve that really helped me to then turn that over and say, hey, I know you guys are really overloaded in school. I know you have a lot on your plate. How can I help you? How are you doing today? How do we help you overcome some of these challenges? And, you know, some kids just, they don't know that they can do it. So it's just nudging them along, like, hey, you can do this. It is possible. It's going to be hard, but it is possible.
You're involved in a lot outside of Pacific Lutheran. Go into a little bit what else you're involved in now.
Yeah, so I also work for Game Changer full-time. So Game Changer is a baseball and softball technology that has now expanded into lots of other sports. So I'm our softball market manager, which is my full-time role. So it's a bit business development, it's a bit of education. So I actually get to go out and talk to coaches all the time about, you know, stats and how do they get better stats and spray charts and all these great tools. I mean, I would have loved to have all these great tools, spray charts, seeing where people hit the ball when we were playing, but now I get to help coaches with the tools to then help athletes say, hey, we notice every time you hit the ball, you pull to the left side, or every time you do this, and helping develop them using that technology. So I get the privilege to talk to coaches all the time, which I feel like are my people. So it's a great way to kind of blend not only my passion for softball, but also, you know, wanting to take my career a long way and also help build softball. So then I can help other women also get in sports technology, which is not always a field where women are feel overly welcome. So I want to make sure that women can see, hey, there's a path forward within technology for you. And hey, you love sports, great. We have a space for you. And I mean, on our team, we have volleyball, we have baseball, we have softball, we have soccer, we have basketball, we have football, we have all these sports. And so I want to make sure that there's space for women within those to not only come into the role, but then thrive and feel welcome.
You've had a chance to thank a number of people. Is there some other folks you may want to thank for your opportunity here now and being in the Hall of Fame?
I mean, I'd be ridiculously silly not to thank my parents. Yeah, I mean, my parents have been incredibly supportive of me. I mean, I'm one of five kids. I'm the middle. I was the most, like, busy child ever. I did all the things, and my parents were like, well, if it's in the budget, we'll do it. I mean, I tried basketball, I tried soccer, I tried volleyball. I think I tried to talk them into ice skating at one point. It did not go well. But I really wanted to try all the things, and my parents were like, yeah, let's try all the things. And I truly believe that's why, I mean, Coach, I was a bit raw, but it's because I played all these sports, and so I got here, and then I got a chance to more refine them. And you know, it's not always a path that works out well, but I really enjoyed that I got to play all these things, recognize that, wow, I really love softball. I have a knack for softball. And because of their support and their willingness to, you know, instead of going on a vacation, we went to softball tournaments. Instead of going to do something fun, we went to a pitching lesson. Not that pitching lessons are fun, but not the same. But just like their willingness to not only support me, but push me, right? Push me along, nudge me along. And then my younger sister also ended up playing at Oregon State, so because of their willingness to kind of push me through, it also opened up doors for my younger sister. So, like, they have been so supportive of everything, and I mean, they flew out here, they flew out yesterday, they're flying out back to Portland today. Like, the quick turnaround, like, I cannot thank you guys enough for being here, but also, you know, the other 30 years of my life. And then the Lewises, cannot forget to thank them. They were my adoptive parents when I was here. They came to my senior ceremony, took me to dinner, just chatted me up, oh, hey, how are things? And just were people I could not imagine my time here without. I just so appreciate your love and support. Their daughter, Jana, was number 7 when she was here. And so, you know, just take out the J, put it in the Anna, and number 7, and you know, you got me. So I was so fortunate to not only get to play a sport that I love and succeed, but have people here who made me feel like I was their daughter. Like, they were like, oh, well, here, we'll bring you some snacks, or, oh, do you need anything? Just like the things that are, you know, they're so small at the moment, you don't even think about it, but when you look back, you're like, they really cared about me. They were thinking about how can I make sure that she feels welcome and she feels loved and she feels supported here. And not to mention, I mean, so many other parents, I can't even go through all the other parents. And I mean, I had my senior year, I had roomed with Hannah, Aaron, and Meredith. And like, we were called the Blondourage. We were all blonde. It was a thing. And like, their parents just loved on us, cooked us food, were there for us. Meredith also came from Oregon and just her, like her coming with me just made it so much easier to be here and have someone from home that we both knew and got up to all kinds of fun together. So my time here was so special. And again, it all comes back to the people. Without the people in your life, without those relationships you build, like what is life without people that you can share the great memories with? So I'm just so thankful for the entire community. And just all the opportunities I had to succeed and then, you know, also get to give back and build my life from that.
I'd be remiss if I didn't do this in celebration of softball and celebration of your career, but I also want to point out that I mentioned that Coach Hawkins has 1,015 wins. Well, the 1,000th win came about 3 weeks ago down in Florida, so congratulations in front of this group. Woo! Congratulations to Anna Miller-Nickel, our newest member of the USC Upstate. All right, our second honoree that we will now bring to the podium is Brittany Starling.
Being in the Hall of Fame, it just means that it's good to know that the hard work that I put in got some sort of recognition and the appreciation was there from the school. When I came in, I was a young kid just coming in thinking I'm just going to be playing basketball, but never had an idea of what I was going to end up finishing with and how my life was going to change once I got here. But being inducted into the Hall of Fame just is an amazing honor, and it just feels like I'm in the presence of a lot of amazing and great people, and it's just so much support around it that it's almost like hard to believe a little bit, but it's very exciting, and to me it just means that all my hard work didn't go unnoticed.
So Anna, our other honoree, came from roughly 3,000 miles away, third across the country. You came from 3 hours away in Sumter, South Carolina. Tell us about your journey to USC Upstate.
Yeah, so being from Sumter, when I was getting my, a lot of my college offers actually came from in-state, and I had a feeling I was going to end up choosing a college that was in-state, and that was okay, because I obviously wanted my family to be able to make as many games as possible, and I also, didn't want to be too close, but not too far. But it worked out perfect, and I came here, I actually signed my scholarship or my letter of intent a week before I ended up tearing my ACL and missing my senior year in high school. So that was kind of a moment in itself, but it just felt good to know once the injury happened and I called the coaches and I told them what happened, there was not a lick of surprise, there was not a lick of a feeling of nervousness or worry in their voices. They didn't care. They knew, you got a whole 9 months to get yourself together, we'll be ready for you. So that was an amazing feeling. But, I signed my my letter of intent right before that injury and got here, and, things just completely changed for me. No one was looking at my knee. No one was worrying about my knee. They expected me to come out here and perform. And that was, what I tried to do.
You're here today with one of your teammates and one of your best friends, Brittany Clancy. Together, you got USC Upstate's 2 postseason appearances, and before we let Brittany Clancy talk, I'm going to go once again back off the script like I was supposed to earlier, and we're going to learn more. Can't believe I did this twice. We're going to learn more about Brittany Starling.
A native of Sumter, South Carolina, Brittany Starling competed at USC Upstate from 2012 to 2016 and graduated as one of the most accomplished players in Upstate women's basketball history. She is the lone player in program history to score 1,000 points and grab 1,000 rebounds. A College Sports Madness All-Mid-Major team selection in 2016, Starling was a 2-time All-ASUN selection. earning first-team all-conference honors in 2016 after ranking fifth in the NCAA in total rebounds, sixth in rebounds per game, and seventh in double-doubles. Starling also finds her name littered across the USC Upstate record book as she ranks top 10 in program history in 15 different career statistical categories. She holds the program records for career rebounds, career defensive rebounds, and games played while ranking fourth in scoring. Please welcome Brittany Starling.
Let's let you talk about your teammate here a little bit. You know, I had a chance to watch an interview this week between the two of you. In fact, it was part of that video there. And you talked about your friend's tenacity on the court. And what was it that made your teammate, Brittany Starling, so good on the floor?
Yeah, so it was obvious that she was what I call a beast on the court. Her skill level was amazing. But what separated her from others and being great was her mental toughness and her discipline. That encouraged the rest of the teammates, including myself, to want to come out and work hard with her, which eventually led to two good seasons out of the 4 years that we played. But it was really just the discipline to be great, and her determination was just, it drived everyone else to want to be great with her.
Now, this isn't a Friars Club roast, so if there's a repeatable fun story about your teammate, now's a great time to share it.
So we'll keep this PG. So I do remember one time, or it was two games in the same week, and we went to Jersey to play, and they used to get on me all the time about my passing ability. So after every game, she's like, Clint, I go by Clint, she goes by Star. You can do it. Pass me the ball. Lob it. And I would be scared, and I'm like, I don't know, I'm hesitant. So we went to Jersey, and at halftime, it was like a buzzer beater. I gave her a lob, and she made the buzzer beater basket. And I said, Star, did you like that pass? She was like, yeah, Clint, that's what you're supposed to do. And so I'm like, that's not the energy that I wanted, but all right, okay. So then we turned around and came back and had a home game that same week, and it was a fast break. And I remember I had got the rebound, and she sprinted down the court. And on the fast break, I did a nice bounce pass to her, and she scored the layup. And I believe it was a close game, so I think we went up by maybe 4 or 6 points at that point. And we literally went in sync, and we went up for a chest bump. And so afterwards, I was like, that's what I needed before. I didn't think I would do that. So that's one of the fun moments on the court. But we've had plenty of fun moments off the court, which led to our closeness playing together. With the long talks at nighttime or in the morning or on the bus with those long travels. And the dance-offs and all that in our dorm rooms and on the charter bus. But, yeah.
And so it's untrue. There was a lot of time to have a dance-off in some of those buses, I'm sure. Brittany Starling. Star, I guess I'll now go Star in class since you're up to the dorm room. Share with us some of your favorite moments and your experiences here at Upstate.
I think, honestly, my most favorite moment was our last year together. I think that was by far the best. To me, I know we made two postseasons, but that was probably the best year we had together. Actually, going into our senior year, Quincy and I decided to stay up here and not go home over the summer. Quincy went and did an internship, and I went and worked at Upper Star Center, and we decided to just stay here, work out together, and just kind of prepare for our senior year. And I think in so doing that, we got so much closer off the court, which obviously helped us get closer on the court. And I think our energy together kind of brought in the other, you know, our younger kids that were coming in and the returners that were coming back as well. And we ended up just having an amazing season. We met and we played against a couple of pitchers showed North Carolina, which was a big moment because I think every girl in the world at some point wants to play for North Carolina when you're playing AAU and things like that. So just that entire season was just so amazing because we just, honestly, it was probably the most fun I had playing basketball in a very long time. And I think a lot of that came from just the preparation that we put in together, not even thinking about what we were doing, we were just doing it and it felt right. But it ended up leading us to have just an amazing, amazing senior year. We had so much fun on the court, off the court. It was just a really, really, really fun and good year.
What are some of the influential people that you had that impacted your career?
Well, of course, I got to start with my sister right here. Honestly, when I think about basketball, it's hard. Oh, God, I'm getting emotional.
Rhode Island is neither a road nor an island.
When I think about basketball, it's really hard to not think about who supported you along the way. Of course, I can start with my parents who have been there since day one and just always been here for me. But when I think about my time here and I think about my sister sitting beside me, this girl has been nothing but a huge support to me since day one. When freshman year was hard, she was right there leading up until today when I signed my rookie contract to go play overseas. She actually moved right away to Cleveland to work, and I went right overseas. And I think the distance brought us closer because we started calling each other every single week and just being there for each other for that support because we were alone. But even from there, she's just been the biggest support that I've had here at Upstate, and it's just been amazing to have someone like that in your corner because I can honestly say I wouldn't be who I am or have done what I've done without this girl right here beside me.
You did a nice segue without even knowing that. You did a nice segue into your pro career, and that's a big part of your basketball journey is after you left Upstate, well, you went to four countries, you had a pro career, including being the MVP of the league in Finland, winning a team championship in Finland. Tell us something about that experience, not only basketball related, but culturally too. I mean, you've seen some places overseas.
Yeah, honestly, playing overseas was... Man, I can say the highlight of just me playing basketball, period. Because again, I never imagined myself going overseas in the first place, let alone playing basketball in foreign countries. That wasn't really something I thought about doing. It kind of just happened. I spent 4 years in Belgium total. I played in Finland. I also played in Brazil. And then, I did some time in Spain with the national team there. And it was honestly just an amazing thing. I think it speaks a lot about a person's character, as well as, of course, their athletic ability when you can go to a foreign country and you don't speak the same language, but once your presence is involved with these people over there, they meet you and they love you so much. It's not very often you see teams wanting to bring players back. Usually players kind of do a 1 year somewhere and they kind of move on for their own reasons. Maybe they want to keep going to different places or, sometimes the team just doesn't bring them back. But I can honestly say I've been blessed to say every team that I played for has wanted me to come back. They did not want me to leave. And when I decided to leave a country, other teams in that country wanted me to come play for their team as well. And I think that says a lot about just, I guess what I brought. People really enjoy being around me. I still get messages right now from a team in Belgium wanting me to come back and play. It's not going to happen, but it just feels good to know. It feels good to know that I bring something that they enjoy. I get messages all the time, and it's just been an amazing, amazing experience to be able to travel the world and do something that I love and to continue getting better at what I was doing.
Daniel mentioned this a little earlier, but like Hannah and like Ramiro, who we'll hear from in just a minute, each of you in this Hall of Fame class now giving back to some of the next generation. Tell us about what you're doing now in your hometown and your role here in Sumter.
Yeah, so I'm actually the athletic director at the Family YMCA in Sumter, and basically I am in charge of church league basketball. I organize, schedule, and I run church league basketball for ages about 3 to 14. And then I also, right now, I'm in the middle of spring soccer, which is ages 3 through 8. And then I will be taking over Camp McBoykin, which is an outdoor camp out in the woods in Pinewood, South Carolina. So I'll be doing that as well. And I also recently just got started a program called the Y Leaders Club, which I bring in. I have about 11 teenagers in that group. And we meet weekly and they do volunteer hours and we just work on building them up as young leaders of the future, basically. We have weekly meetings where we have different types of discussions and topics and we just do different events where we kind of just work on them branching out and getting kind of out of that social anxiety bubble that a lot of kids are dealing with right now. And it's just been an amazing thing to be a part of and to kind of get started. But honestly, watching those kids play basketball and play soccer is just really fun, and seeing the excitement in them and obviously watching them develop a love for the game is really fun to watch as well. So that's kind of what I do.
And when you talk about Pinewood, I know exactly where you're talking about because you and I are from about 20 miles apart. So yeah. That's really, really cool. Anyone else that you'd like to thank for your journey here and not only for this honor today, but in your journey and life so far?
I mean, honestly, like I said, I'm keep going back to my sister beside me. I just have to keep because, again, I wouldn't be who I am if I didn't have this girl beside me. my parents who've been supporting me since day one. My brother got off work 5 o'clock this morning to make sure that he was still here for me, and I mean, things like that just mean a whole lot to me when you talk about support. I have my second family here with me as well, who, you know, since the day I met them, they've been nothing but support for me, and that just, honestly, it's just things like that mean the world to me, just to have those people in my corner who want to see me do better. My mentor, Mr. Mills, is here as well, and he's been, since I met him, he's just always been there for me as well, just kind of encouraging me and supporting me to continue just being who I am and being the best that I can be. So, I mean, honestly, I'm just blessed to have just a great group of people behind me that continue pushing me through life. And it's amazing to say, although I'm no longer playing basketball, I still have these people behind me pushing me to just be what I can be in life, and that's amazing.
Well, and behind every Hall of Famer, there's a Hall of Fame team that pushes them there, and that's exactly what you're outlining there. Later today, you'll have your ceremonial first pitch of softball, so try not to box out and post up Hannah before you leave.
All right.
Let's hear it for Brittany Starling. Here's the Hall of Fame.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Our next presentation, I think I will actually get in order, because it is all in one video.
A native of Argentina, Ramiro Blanco competed at USC Upstate from 2009 to 2012 and graduated as one of the top players in USC Upstate history. A member of the A-Sun All-Decade team, he was a four-time All-A-Sun selection, culminating with a pair of first-team All-Conference honors in 2011 and 2012. In singles action, Blanco posted a career mark of 67-17, as his 67 singles wins ranks third all-time in program history, while his 798 career winning percentage is the best in program history. As a freshman, he concluded the 2009 season a perfect 23-0 on the year, becoming the first player in program history to achieve a perfect season, establishing a program-long winning streak in the process. As a doubles competitor, Blanco finished with a 59-23 career mark, with his 59 victories ranking fourth all-time in program history, posting a 720 winning percentage in doubles action. He stands as one of two players in program history to hold a 720 or greater winning percentage in both singles and doubles competition. USC Upstate Hall of Famer Ramiro Blanco.
Joined now by Ramiro Blanco, our newest member of the USC Upstate Athletics Hall of Fame. Ramiro, welcome and congratulations.
Lenny, thank you very much. Thank you very much for, setting up this call.
Yeah, when I say USC Upstate Athletics Hall of Famer, what goes to your mind first?
Well, I mean, it's tough to put it in words, you know, I'm super proud to be part of this selective group. It's incredible. I work really hard during my entire life to play tennis, to get better, and just being part of this small group, you know, it's just incredible. I feel super proud.
Talk about your journey here to USC Upstate. What led you here to Spartanburg?
Wow, I mean, it's a long story. Do we have the time?
We got all the time you need.
Awesome. But it's crazy, because the thing is, in Argentina at that time, you know, it was really weird for tennis players to go to the US to play college tennis. Most of the players in my age or with the ones that I was practicing at that time and all the stuff, you know, they just wanted to play pro. And the second option to play pro, it was going to Europe to play interclubs and tournaments for money, and then, you know, save some money to go to the tour. And going to the US, it was not even an option. At that time, I didn't know any tennis player doing that. So the best friend of my dad, he lives in San Francisco, and I have a really good relationship with him. And he was always telling me, like, man, you need to come to the US, you know, you need to play tennis for school. And I'm like, I mean, what is that? I mean, I play tennis, how am I gonna end up in the school? And he says, like, yeah, they give like scholarships and all the stuff. And I'm like, all right, I'm gonna take a look. And at that time, you know, like, it was back in 2008. I was planning to play pro at that time, and we had some issues with my family, you know, like my dad lost his job, you know, and at that time, you know, I was kind of, you know, in that moment of my life that I mean, my idea at the time was playing pro and I needed a lot of money. And I'm like, all right, now that I don't have this support anymore, let's see. I mean, what is this, you know? And I start checking, analyzing the option. And I mean, it was the best decision I ever took, you know? I start talking with Alessandro, that at that time was the head coach, Alessandro De Marzo from Peru. It was good because at that time my English level was really bad. And with Alessandro, I could speak Spanish, you know, and he was the one who recruited me. And so it was crazy because, you know, like it was my first time in the US. I'm a big fan of the movie Home Alone. I really like when he goes to New York, you know, and he's there. So I was expecting, you know, something like that. And when I arrived to Spartanburg, I was like, where are the buildings, you know? and the massive city. But yeah, no, I mean, I had an incredible time, you know, I really enjoyed. And since the beginning, you know, I just had an incredible experience. So I'm really thankful for that.
Let's talk about some of those experiences now. You know, you had a great career here. And do you have a couple of seminal moments, a couple of those really moments that really stand out to you in your career here as a Spartan?
Yes, I mean, I do have, you know, I mean, it's really tough to mention the most important or but now that you have that trophy behind, I would say, like, as an athlete, you know, like when we beat ETSU and we were able to win the conference, you know, that for us was incredible. So in my freshman year, 1 year before winning the conference tournament, the tournament. It was a regular season because we were not allowed to play the tournament because we needed, like, I think 4 or 5 years in Division I in order to play the tournament. And at that time, I think when I studied in USC Upstate, it was like the second year in Division I. So as a freshman, we knew that the biggest rival we had, it was ETSU, East Tennessee University. And we were having a really good season. We were undefeated in our conference. And we had the last match or the last game of the season against ETSU at home in 2009. And we ended up losing 4-3. Like we lost the deciding match, match. And that was really sad. I mean, I had an incredible tennis season in my freshman year, but we ended up losing, you know, like the conference against ETSU. And the year after, in 2010, we had our revenge. We play against them again, the last match of the season against them at their home. And they had like a winning streak for like 5 years or so. They were undefeated for the last 50 matches or something like that at home. They were really strong, you know, in Johnson City. I remember the place. And I was playing my match and I was winning. I was playing against this guy from Paraguay. I remember that day really well. And I was winning like 6-1, 4-1, really easy, playing really good. And then, you know, like I started losing my concentration, you know, like it was super packed, you know, like a lot of people outside, you know, and I ended up losing the second set, 7-6. And then when I realized, like the rest of the matches, they finished already and I was just by myself. So we were 3-all and I was playing the third set, you know, like playing like the deciding match against ETSU. And for us, ETSU, you know, like we were just from the beginning of the season or since the beginning of the season, just thinking about them, you know, like every practice was like, we need to beat ETSU. We need to beat ETSU because we were like by far the best two teams in the conference. And since we were not able to play the tournament, like actually our season, you know, like our goal, it was beating ETSU because then we knew that we were going to win the conference. And I ended up winning my match. It was like 6-3 in the third set. So we beat ETSU. They lost after a long time. And I remember exactly the last point, you know, like, I mean, this happened, 13 years ago. And I still remember that day as if it would be, you know, today. I mean, it was incredible. I just finished, lay down, and then all my teammates, you know, like came, jumped on me, you know, I couldn't even breathe, you know, but it was such an incredible experience.
That's awesome. That's terrific. You talked about that freshman year of yours. Expound on that a little bit, because as a freshman, you talked about your experience now coming to Upstate. You rolled the table. You went 23-0 your freshman year. Talk about how that year just sort of kept building on itself.
Yeah, no, I mean, it was incredible, you know. I remember, so I studied classes, you know. I studied in the spring, actually, you know. So for us, you know, for tennis players, studying in the spring is tough because you just start in the middle of the season. I mean, you start and you start school and you start competing right away. So I remember, you know, like I took the decision to go to the US to play college tennis, like in, I would say, September in 2008. So when I talked to Alessandro, the coach at that time, he told me, man, we need you for January. You need to be there. You need to be here like in 4 months. And I'm like, all right, what should I do? And he says like, yeah, you need to take the SAT. You need to take the TOEFL. You need to apply for school. And I'm like, man, I need to do all the stuff, you know, like in 4 months. All right, let's do it. And so when I received the SAT score, it was like December, middle of December. So I was running out of time. I need to be there for the beginning of the spring. So I passed the SAT. I got accepted into school. And when they sent me the I-20, I was like, it was the beginning of January already. You know, I needed to go to the US Embassy and get the visa and get a flight right away. So when I went to the US Embassy, I showed my I-20, and the I-20 says like, last name, Ramiro, first name, Blanco. So instead of, you know, say like first name, so my first name is Ramiro, my last name is Blanco. So it was opposite. And because of that, they say like, no, we cannot give you the I-20 is wrong. We cannot give you the visa like that. You need to talk to your school again, and they need to send you another I-20. And at that time, they need to mail the I-20. Right now, they accept it if they send it via email. At that time, they have to mail it, you know? So I need to wait like 1 week extra for the school to get a new I-20 and send me, you know, the correct one. So I ended up arriving to school like on January 20th or something like that, 20-something. So I started classes, you know, like 2 weeks later. I remember I arrived and one professor the first day says like, all right, guys, we need a test. And I'm like, hello, nice to meet you. I just arrived here and I don't speak English, you know, so I don't know. Yeah, it was crazy the beginning. So I lost the first match against Georgia. We played against Georgia, UGA, that they have really, really good team. And then after that, we traveled to New York and we played against Yale and some other schools. And I remember I did not play the first two games. I was just there, you know, like watching them, and I wanted to play so bad, but the coach was like, yeah, I really want to take care of you. You should start practicing. In Argentina, we play red clay instead of hard courts, you know, so red clay is a much slower court. So I needed to get used to the hard court, you know, like an indoors that is even faster. So I remember we were at the hotel to play our last game against Yale. And we were about to leave the hotel, and one of the players took a little bit extra having breakfast, and the coach says like, we leave in 5 minutes, and this guy did not show up, and we left him. So he says, Rama, Ramiro, get used that you're gonna play. And that's where I play my first game, and I remember we lost 6-1. I was 5-2 against a Yale, and I won my doubles point and my singles point. And since then, you know, like I think I played every single match during the rest of my career. But it was crazy. I finished with a record 23-0 that I believe it was the first time in the history of the school. And I don't know like how many other players, you know, like ended up with an undefeated record, you know, in all the schools, you know. So it was incredible. But yeah, such an incredible time. And I ended up playing like really good tennis.
Yeah, that actually is the longest winning streak in the program as well. So yeah, it's pretty rare to be doing that. So how did your experience here at USC Upstate prepare you for the future? What has been your career since your time here in Spartanburg?
I mean, everything that I, big part of what I am right now is because of my experience at USC Upstate. You know, like I started as a really young guy. I was only 19 years old when I went to Upstate, and 4 years later or 5 years later, I was already a man, you know, so it helped me a lot. It was an incredible experience. And imagine right now I have a company that I take student athletes to the US just to, yeah, I want people to live the same experience that I had in the US, you know. So, I mean, just being a kid, you know, far away from your home. I don't know, it was so good, you know, and that's the good thing, you know, like when you are just 19 years old and you are far away from your family, far away from your friends. Argentina is a place that family is everything, you know, and friends are everything. And at the beginning it was tough, but yeah, I found an incredible tennis team at the time. I had like really good friends, you know, and your friends, they basically become your family. And those guys that I didn't know them at all at the beginning of my experience there, after a couple of weeks, they were part of my family. And I still have really good relationship with most of them. In my junior year, my brother joined me in the tennis team as well. So he ended up graduating from USC Upstate one year later than me. So yeah, for me, I mean, USC Upstate is like, it's like family.
What are you doing today? You mentioned it a little bit, but expound a little bit on what are you up to now?
Yeah, so when I came back to Argentina, first of all, I started working for ExxonMobil, the oil company. So I was working for Exxon for 3 years. It was a really good experience. And after that, I just decided to quit. I went to Spain for grad school. And I built the company that I have today, that is, the name is BK Team. That is a company that we take, as I mentioned, student athletes from Argentina. I mean, we studied in Argentina, and now we grew up into different countries in South America. We are in Chile, we are in Peru, we are in Bolivia. So yeah, we help student athletes, you know, to go to the US. We kind of represent them, you know, like we are the contact point between, or the bridge between them and the coaches. And we help close to 100 kids already. I have this company with my brother and with another friend. And so yeah, we are doing a really good job, you know, like we are really happy with what we have so far. And I'm also, last year, I started building a tennis complex in my hometown. So yeah, right now I have two tennis courts, you know, and two courts for mini tennis for the little ones. And yeah, the business is going great, you know, like it's like a club and it's super packed, you know, always full of kids running around, you know. So it's great because right now I kind of, you know, like working with two things that they are my passion, because I mean, I love tennis. Tennis gave me everything. And also I had a chance to help student athletes to go to the US. That to me was an incredible experience. So yeah, I'm having a really good time.
That's awesome. Who would you like to thank? Influential people or others you'd like to thank for your opportunity and the journeys that you've had?
Oh, okay. See, it's tough because many people helped me a lot there. I would say probably, first of all, the coaches, Alessandro, who was the one who believed in me at the beginning and helped me out, you know, to or gave me the scholarship to be able to do it. And then he quit or got fired. I don't know exactly what happened there, but we got a new coach, Oliver, that at that time, you know, like when Oliver arrived, it was my third semester in school. And after the first meeting we had, he told me like, hey, Rama, I want you to be my captain. I know that we have older people in the team, or people with more experience than you, but I want you to be my captain. And that was really important to me because he gave me that responsibility. I ended up playing like my best tennis during my time with Oliver. So he was really, really helpful. And then, yeah, then I mean, all the professors, you know, like the athletic staff at that time, Sandy, that I believe Sandy's still at Upstate. Yeah. I love Sandy. I mean, he was always there with us, you know, like really, really, really nice guy. I still have him on Facebook, and we haven't talked in a while, but I really like him. And of course, all my teammates, you know, my friends at school, you know, like my brother. I mean, they were all part of this incredible experience, and it wouldn't be possible without them, you know. So yeah, all of them. And I'm sorry if I'm missing someone else, but for sure, like more people.
Absolutely. Well, certainly want to wish you congratulations and welcome to the club. As you mentioned, it's not a vast group. There's about 95 members of the USC Upstate Athletic Hall of Fame, and you are now one of them. Congratulations and all the best to you.
Thank you very much. I feel bad that I'm not going to be able to make it to the ceremony. But yeah, unfortunately, right now I'm in Argentina. Tickets are so expensive, and it's tough to me to make it there. But I'm definitely, I'm definitely gonna go there, you know, like probably in the upcoming year, you know, just to be able to visit the school a little bit and yeah, have the chance to meet all of you. So thank you very much. I would like to thank my family as well, my friends here in Argentina, that if they see this and they realize that I haven't named them, they're gonna get jealous. And yeah. Thank you, Lenny, as well for making this interview.
No problem. Well, we look forward to meeting you here down the road. And once again, congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Appreciate Ramiro. It was a really interesting conversation we had both on the camera and off. He was a really fun guy to talk to. So I want to thank a few people. I want to thank our catering folks with Sodexo for today's event. If you want to grab something else to eat on the way out or a coffee on the way out, please feel free to do so. I want to thank my staff, Marlise over here, who ran the slides in the order of which I called them out, but not the order we practiced. I want to thank Ann Hannah and Jared Bradley, who are great, and Juan Soto, who helped us with our videos as well. Ryan Fry and Kendra Tillman on our communication staff, and the rest of our staff here. Nate, who had to duck out a little bit as well, for helping us with this event today. Like I said, this is the kickoff of a long day. We look forward to seeing all of you over in our softball field. For the roughly 12:40 ceremonial first pitch, we'll have you over there at 12:40, and then once everything is set, we'll get everybody ready for the first pitch prior to our softball team playing Winthrop at 1:00. Before our honorees leave, we do want to get a couple pictures with the two of you both here and in front of the media backdrop, and any family photos and that sort of stuff. Jerry can take those with them as well. We'll make access available to those pictures coming up next week. So once again, let's have a great round of applause for Anna Miller-Nickel and Brittany Starling. With that, we'll close out today's event, and we'll get some pictures taken. And once again, thank you all for being here, and congratulations.